In this video, we're going to take a closer look at the conservation of energy. Energy is conserved. We can't create it and we can't destroy it. This law is a huge help when it comes to finding answers to energy questions. We're going to practice finding some of those answers, and as we do, keep an eye out for how this law is put to use. We saw earlier that energy can be divided into two types, kinetic and potential. Kinetic energy has to do with an object's motion, and potential energy has to do with its position. Imagine a process that takes place over time, say the flight of a football from when it's thrown to when it's caught. The law of conservation of energy says that the total energy of the football, kinetic plus potential, is constant while the ball is in the air. To see this, we'll need to recall how to calculate energy due to motion and energy due to position. The kinetic energy of an object equals 1/2 the object's mass times its velocity squared. An object's potential energy, when that stored energy is created by the force of gravity, equals its mass, m, times its height above ground, h, times g, the acceleration due to gravity. Now back to our example problem. The football has a mass of 0.4 kilograms and is thrown with an initial velocity of 13 meters per second and a height of 2 meters above the ground. Assuming energy is conserved without any loss to air resistance, how fast is the football going when it's 10 meters off the ground? We've been saying that energy is conserved, but what does that really mean when it comes to solving equations? It means that the number we get when we add up an object's kinetic energy plus potential energy is always the same. As an equation, we write that the initial kinetic energy plus the initial potential energy is equal to the final kinetic energy plus the final potential energy. This is just like saying that the initial energy is the same as the final energy. Energy is conserved. Let's apply this to our question. We can substitute our equations for kinetic and gravitational potential energies into the law of conservation of energy, seen here. We know three things. First, our initial kinetic energy is 1/2 times the mass, 0.4 kilograms times the initial velocity, 13 meters per second squared, which equals 34 joules. Second, our initial gravitational potential energy is mass, 0.4 kilograms, times the initial height, 2 meters, times the acceleration due to gravity, 9.8 meters per second squared, or 7.8 joules. And third, our final gravitational potential energy is the mass, 0.4 kilograms, times the final height, 10 meters, times the acceleration due to gravity, 9.8 meters per second squared, or 39 joules. Now let's rearrange our equation to solve for V final, the football's velocity, which is 10 meters off the ground. First, let's add the numbers on the left side of the equation, 34 joules plus 7.8 joules. That gives us 41.8 joules on the left. Now subtract 39 joules on both sides. That gives us 2.8 joules equals 1/2 mass times the final velocity squared. Multiply both sides by 1 divided by 1/2 times mass. This leaves us with 5.6 joules divided by the mass equals the final velocity squared. Plugging in our mass of 0.4 kilograms, and that gives us 14 joules per kilogram equals the final velocity squared. Take the square root of both sides, and that gives us a final velocity of 3.7 meters per second. That's how fast conservation of energy says the football is moving when it's 10 meters above the ground. Let's try another question, but this time we'll figure out how to solve for a potential energy term. As a finalist in the National Pogo Stick High Jump Competition, you know that if you can reach a height of 3 meters off the ground, you'll win first prize. After months of training, you are able to achieve an upward velocity of 8 meters per second as you bounce off the ground. Will this upward velocity be enough to reach your target height and win the championship? To find out, let's first recognize that this is an energy conservation question. That means our starting point is to write down that our initial energy equals our final energy. Since total energy equals kinetic energy plus potential, we then rewrite to say that our initial kinetic energy plus gravitational potential energy equals our final kinetic plus gravitational potential energy. You may notice that we can even expand the equation again to the basic terms that make up kinetic and potential energy, mass and speed, and height and gravity. Now, take a good look at that equation. Notice that the mass, which in this case includes you and the pogo stick, is in every term, which means we can factor it out. That means we can divide both sides of the equation by the mass and see it disappear. This is pretty amazing. It means that in this case, the mass of the system doesn't change the outcome. Using the streamlined statement of energy conservation, what's our next step? Think about bouncing on a pogo stick. When you're headed down, right as you are touching the ground, just about to leave the ground, your height above the ground is zero. At that point, all of your energy is kinetic. And when you're at a maximum height, at that point, your velocity is zero, and all of your energy is potential. So we know that H initial, our starting height, is zero, and our velocity at our highest point is also zero. This eliminates initial potential energy and final kinetic energy from our energy conservation equation, which now looks like this. 1/2 our initial velocity squared equals our final height times the acceleration due to gravity. In our situation, we want to know the final height, if it is above 3 meters. So let's rearrange our terms to get an equation that says H final equals something. To do that, we just need to divide both sides of the equation by G. And there we have it. Our final height equals our initial velocity squared, divided by 2 times G, the acceleration due to gravity. Plugging in 8 meters per second for our initial velocity and 9.8 meters per second squared for G, we find our final height is 3.3 meters. With this height, you will be able to win the competition. Let's work one more example, this time including spring energy into the scenario. A large, powerful spring is set up vertically with one end fixed to the ground. The spring's constant is 2,000 newtons per meter, and at an equilibrium, it is 3 meters long. You set an 8-kilogram bowling ball on the spring and compress it 1.5 meters. Then the spring is released, and the bowling ball launches straight up in the air. What is the maximum height the ball reaches? Go ahead, press pause, give it a try, and when you think you have the answer, come back and check your work. Did you get 30 meters? If so, great work. If not, let's solve it together. The law of conservation of energy applies here. All the spring energy is turned into kinetic energy of the bowling ball, which turns into gravitational potential energy as the ball slows to a stop as the ball reaches its maximum height in the air. To figure out how high the ball goes, we'll focus on two points in time. When the spring is compressed to half its length, 2, and when the ball is at its maximum height in the air, 3. The law of conservation of energy says the total energy when the spring is compressed is equal to the total energy when the ball is at its highest point. As an equation, we can write it as the initial potential energy plus the initial kinetic energy equals the final potential energy plus the final kinetic energy. In this example, we have two kinds of potential energy: gravitational and spring potential energy. The kinetic energy plus gravitational potential energy plus spring potential energy initially equals the final kinetic energy plus gravitational potential energy plus spring potential energy. So we can rewrite the energy equation to include those separate terms. 1/2 the bowling ball's mass, m, times the initial velocity, v sub I squared, plus the mass, m, times the ball's height above ground, H sub I, times the acceleration due to gravity, G, plus 1/2 the spring constant, K, times the displacement of the spring's initial compression from the equilibrium position, X sub I squared, is equal to 1/2 M, times the final velocity, V sub F squared, plus M times G, times the ball's final height, H sub F, plus 1/2 K, times the spring's final displacement from equilibrium position, X sub F squared. Notice that the ball's initial velocity, V sub I, and final velocity, V sub F, are both zero. That means we can drop those terms out of the equation. We also see that when the ball is up in the air, X sub F is zero. That means we can remove this term from the equation. We want to solve for H sub F, the maximum height of the bowling ball. So let's rearrange this equation to get H sub F on one side by itself. Divide both sides of the equation by M times G. We now have an equation that will let us solve for H sub F, the maximum height of the bowling ball. To solve for H sub F, we add our initial height, which is 1.5 meters to 1/2 times the constant K, which is 2,000 newtons per meter, times the initial displacement of the spring from the equilibrium position, 1.5 meters squared, divided by our mass of 8 kilograms times the acceleration due to gravity, 9.8 meters per second squared. Plugging all these numbers in, we find the maximum height above ground of the bowling ball is 30 meters. That's a closer look at conservation of energy. For more physics in motion, go to our homepage where the entire series is available to you.